Hi, this is Dr. Bertalan Meskó, the medical futurist, and today I want to talk about RFID chips and whether or not it's a good idea to implant one.
So you have something else that's really interesting in the newsletter about people in Sweden implanting, putting implants, microchips, right,
yes,
into them. We've seen something like this here. There was a company that
in Wisconsin,
right,
yeah,
so they could get stuff out of the vending machine,
yeah,
with these microchips. So what's happening in Sweden?
In the past couple of years, Sweden has seen a growing number of people getting microchips implanted under their skin. It was once a very niche thing among the most dedicated biohackers, but now it's becoming mainstream in the tech-savvy and open-minded Scandinavian nation. And I'm a proud geek, so I wanted to get one too. RFID technology has been around for a long time. It is a tag or a label that can exchange data with a reader through radio frequency, or RF, hence the name. There are thousands of applications for it. We use them in our credit cards, we tag our luggage with it, and we implant our pets with it, so they always carry contact information in case they get lost. It's a simple but wonderful technology. What's new is that now we can implant it in our body too. I asked my community if anyone has done it, and Eric Orlovsky, a Swedish anthropologist, came through, so I asked him what his experience was like.
Hi, my name is Eric, and I recently returned from my 3 months thesis fieldwork in Sweden researching microchips, and now I'm here to answer a few questions about them. About popularity, I think it's important to understand that there's only about 5,000 people in Sweden with an implant and out of a population of 10 million, so they're relatively popular but not super widespread. Much of the relative popularity, I think, stems from Sweden being a very tech-optimistic culture. So there's this willingness to try out new technologies without necessarily being worried about kind of the big risks or the kind of big things that could go wrong. I have a chip. I got it right here about 3 months ago when I started my research. And I got it for the same reason that I think many other people I've spoken to have gotten one, and it's curiosity. Obviously, where it stems from is different depending on the individual. And in my case, it stemmed directly from my involvement in the research.
So curiosity and tech optimism are what you need with a little openness. It's like he's describing me. I went online to order an RFID chip from one of the most popular online resellers. They are called Dangerous Things. No red flags whatsoever. And in 2 weeks, they delivered this package. As you open the box, you can tell right away that this is not a toy. They immediately warn you not to meddle with anything to keep it all clean and sterile. But what we do have here is one next implant, one vital key implant, two injectors, two pair of procedure gloves, four antiseptic wipes, two ghost pads for post-injection care, and bandages. Despite their ominous name, Dangerous Things takes the procedure very seriously, and so should you. This is a small operation. Can you imagine that there is no surgical protocol for the injection of these things? And while technically a piercer could do the job, it's highly recommended to do it with a surgeon. And Dangerous Things does help you with this, as on their website, they show you professionally trained partners who are equipped to implant these chips. But what I think is really going to make a difference in terms of chip implants going mainstream is how easy it's going to be to set them up. So I asked the founder from Dangerous Things about what to expect.
You know, the older implants, the NACs that use the NTEG 216, you do have to program those with data that you want to either share or tell it to redirect somebody to a website or something like that. It's a process of getting an app on your phone or using software on your computer and programming it and kind of managing that way. VivoKey products are meant to be plug and play. So you just load the app and follow the instructions, and then you can change the behavior of the chip. When other people scan it, you just change that behavior in the app. So if you want it to go to a URL or share your VivoKey profile information, you just set that configuration change in the app and it's done. Beyond that, for VivoKey, you know, when you want to, for example, like let's say you want to integrate VivoKey authentication into a WordPress blog or a discourse forum or something like that, you load the plugin, you configure it, and then from that point on, you can use the VivoKey instead of a username and password. So you would just go to the blog or WordPress or whatever, say I want to log in with VivoKey, you get a little notification on your phone, you scan your chip, and then you're logged in.
Seems fairly easy. With one of those things, you have the option to customize it more, and with the other, it's as simple as it gets for the basic applications. And at this point, I really had to Google what it's like when they inject it.
Why don't you take a nice big deep breath in, and exhale really slow. There we go.
It's in there.
It's in there. Pretty quick and easy.
It's not too bad, right? Apparently, it feels like a bee sting. A really big bee sting. And just like that, in a few seconds, you can be part of a yet small group whose members are technically cyborgs. And since I'm a huge fan of science fiction, I find this pretty exciting. But as a physician, I wanted to know more before I was about to commit to a medical procedure altering my body, right? So I prepared a few questions for my surgeon friend, Dr. George Varga.
Besides the ethical and privacy-related concerns, RFID implants are thought to be medically safe. Millions of pets are already tagged this way, but it must be noted that no long-term, large population data for human use is available at the moment. In my opinion, it should be carried out in a clean environment, in aseptic circumstances, preferable by someone with anatomical knowledge and experience in performing basic medical procedures. The full recovery can take up to 4 weeks, but it does not interfere with any daily activities. Medical risks of any other implants are presented, like wound complications, tissue infections, allergic reactions, or post-procedural pain. Latest studies have shown that cancer caused by RFID chips is virtually non-existent in humans and negligible for animals. The removal is a bit more complicated than the insertion. After marking the implant site, local anesthetics should be given, and the device can be removed through a small skin incision. That could be closed either by sutures or other sutureless wound closure methods. I suggest that the removal should be performed by a medical professional.
With all these pieces of information, I thought the rewards outweigh the risks. At least for me. With this chip, I could operate doors, unlock my phone, or even carry my boarding pass at airports. It's awesome. I just needed to get the all-go from my wife as we discuss every body-altering technology that I plan to use. Honey, I want to implant myself with
no.
A... So that happened. There in my dreams of becoming a cyborg. Apparently my wife sees a different risk-to-reward ratio. As all RFID chips are hackable, depending on what kind of information I store on my chip, hackers could get access to it. For example, as I said, I could have my phone password right here and unlock it with a wave of my hand, or have all my medical records right here with me at all times. But do I really want to have that information exposed like that? I'm not comfortable with the fact that hackers could access it fairly easily. Another problem is the limitations this technology has right now. It can have a widespread application. You can program a chip for a lot of things, but one chip can only do one thing. And even though the next implant from Dangerous Things has two chips in the physical space of one, it's still not a lot. And even though these chips are passive, meaning they have no internal source of energy and you don't have to change batteries, in case you do want to remove them, as my surgeon friend described, it's way more trouble than implanting them. It requires an actual surgery. So as of now, my RFID enthusiasm is put to rest. The plan is that I'm gonna wait for the tech to catch up with my vision for the future. Because I believe in a few years, chip implants will have better security, bigger capacity, and more customization. We are going to have multiple applications in a single chip. And you're gonna see universal standards for digital identification systems and finally surgical protocols for implantation. And further down the line is when it's going to get really exciting, when these things are going to have sensors that we'll be able to track vital signs to keep our health in check all the time. And with better security, they could revolutionize medical care. Instead of medical data being stored at various hospitals, my GP's office, and at the pharmacy, I could have the chance to establish my own healthcare identity and become the steward of my own data. And imagine all that in a medical emergency situation. The first responders arrive and they only have to scan your hand to get to know every valuable medical information about you. They can spare crucial minutes and really focus on your care. that's when these chips are really going to start changing lives. And that's when I'm going to pitch this idea to my wife again, because then the rewards of this thing will truly worth the trouble. Until then, patience. If you like this episode and would like to hear more about body augmentations and real-life cyborgs, click on the link here or subscribe here.